Okay, everyone, good morning. We are really fortunate to have Professor Anil Prabhakar, who absolutely needs no introduction in this audience, but for the sake of others, I will go ahead and do an introduction. Anil received his PhD in 1997 from Carnegie Mellon University, and then went on to work in the industry, primarily in data storage industry for a few years before joined the Department of Electrical Engineering at IIT Madras in 2002. So he is actually a member of the Scientific Management Board for LIGO India, and that's precisely the reason we have invited him here. So he plays a huge role there, doing all the scientific management around India for the LIGO. And that is to, of course, detect gravity waves. We'll hear more about this shortly. But he's also been involved with the India-based Neutrino Observatory, and currently serves on the editorial boards for Scientific Reports Nature publication and the IEEE Transactions on Magnetics. Of course, in his spare time, he also has been dwaddling into doing entrepreneurship activities. He's the founder of the QNU Labs, incubated by IIT Madras for secure optical communications, and also has been a partner in crime on a company that we both started, Unilumen Photonics, which is focused on fiber lasers commercialization, and is currently the director of YALI Mobility and Enability Foundation, a company that focus on rehabilitation engineering. He has more than 50 research publications and has co-authored a book on spin waves, and has got a few book chapters and 18 patents on a wide range of devices in areas of photonics, magnetics, and assistive devices. So with that introduction, I'll hand over to Anil.
Thanks, Balaji. I did not realize I had so many patents. I'm not sure how many of them have actually been awarded. But yeah, I think at some point, the number of patents and the number of students increase without my understanding how many they are.
Sure.
Okay. So I've been involved in the LIGO scientific collaboration for the last few years. And since LIGO India has been primarily been a theoretical effort, they were very thrilled to get experimentalists on board, because they needed to get. Let me show you a picture of one of the early interferometers that was used. Some of this work has been going on for more like 30 years, and you know, as students, you have to understand the kind of dedication that is required. When these guys were building the first detectors, they were building it around these tubes, and they were trying to do acoustic detections. They had no clear understanding of whether they would see it or not. Only much later did we start looking at Michelson interferometers. Here's a picture of a Michelson interferometer. And the Michelson interferometers that came along when NSF first funded it, which was almost 20 years ago. So they were funding futuristic research. So there's always this question about whether or not we should fund basic science. And, you know, NSF committee, the National Science Foundation in the US, had enough foresight to say that they would fund something like this, although they would not see its value for at least 20 years. Right? So the basic Michelson is shown out here. And these are the large Earth-based detectors that are now in play. In the future, there is work on what is called LISA, which is space-based. There is also one called the Einstein Observatory, which is a larger Earth-based system. Plans for those are also coming up. And I had this interesting conversation where people in the world were asking us whether we wanted to contribute, and India is still humming and hawing about whether we want to contribute to that. And to me, it was a no-brainer, because if you don't start contributing to that today, then you will miss out on the next Nobel Prize. I mean, that's all that there is to it. the numbers out here are revealing, right? And this always boggles the imagination. The H constant out here, I'll talk about a little bit about it, is of the order of 10 to the power minus 21. If you make an interferometer with an arm scale of about 4 kilometers, then you end up with this HL constant, which is 4 into 10 to the power minus 16 centimeters. Now, that delta L is the kind of change in length that you're trying to measure on this Michelson interferometer. And, you know, it has to boggle your mind, because the size of an atom is, I don't know, 10 angstroms maybe, right? That's about 10 to the power minus 10. Or maybe if it's, you know, you try to go smaller than that, maybe you can say 10 to the power minus 11. You're talking of measuring something that is a million times smaller than the size of an atom. Right? How on earth can anyone ever do that is a question, right? Does it even make sense that you're able to measure something like this? So in many ways, this Michelson interferometer is the pinnacle of optical engineering that we have been able to do. I remember I visited the labs at MIT, I think about 6 years ago. And when I looked at it, I said, if there's anybody who's doing optics in this world and they're not involved in this experiment, I mean, there's something seriously wrong, because this is just out of the world type of engineering that is going on. So if you look at the timeline of these detectors, the first bar detectors were in 1970, right? And Ray Weiss, who came up with the concept of the interferometer, did that in the mid 70s. The kilometer scale interferometers started coming up in the 90s, late 90s. Caltech got its interferometer in 1990. Now, you know, some of the people today who are leading the efforts and who are part of the discovery were graduate students in 1990, right? So there's an Indian guy called Rana Adhikari, who was a graduate student in Caltech. And today he's a leading expert, simply because he has spent 20 years doing just gravity wave detection, and he can tell you anything and everything about gravity waves. So one of the things that I do have is a paper that describes a lot of the physics associated with detecting gravity waves with a little bit of general relativity. So I can share that with Balaji, and he can upload it on Moodle, I think. And people who are interested in reading it in more detail can do that. Right. We are right now in the place where the second generation interferometers are being used, and they are the ones that made the detection. And the third generation interferometers, or what we call 3G, are in the planning stage. In IIT Madras itself, we have Deepa, we have Shanti, we have Rachel, and from the control systems group, and we have Prabhu Rajgopal from the mechanical engineering department contributing to different aspects of the second and third generation interferometers. Why are these generations important? This picture sort of explains it in a nutshell. If you look at, this is our known universe. And our known universe, we are at the center of our known universe. The universe is all around us. And somewhere in the middle of this orange circle is where Earth is. What you're looking out at is the orange circle. The orange sphere and the orange circle are the range of the first generation interferometers, Michelson interferometers. And you can see that it was a very small part of our known universe. By the time we came to the second generation, or what we call advanced LIGO, we were able to scale the amplitude sensitivity by a factor of 10. What that means is that our reach in terms of three-dimensional volume became a factor of 1,000. Now, earlier we could detect one event in a day maybe, but with a factor of 1,000, one event in a year, but now with a factor of 1,000, we can detect as many as events as one a day, right? So you don't hear about it all the time, but there is this huge buzz going on constantly about, you know, new detections. And there are black holes all over the place, but of more interest to the physicists are neutron stars and, you know, all sort of exotic type astronomical events that are taking place. But since this is not a lecture on that, I will not go too much into that, right? But there is one slide that people often show, which is to say that our universe, the way we know it, was originally all visible, and then it became infrared. Then there was this cosmic background explorer, which looked at the microwave radiation. Then there was the gravity waves, the gamma rays. I forget what the GRBs are. And then there were the gravity waves. So the question is, if you have a new telescope, which is what the Michelson interferometer is, what all will you see? Will you see what structure will you see? The microwave background radiation showed that there was no structure and it was part of the remnants of the Big Bang, right? There's a huge gamma ray burst happening in the equatorial plane of our galaxy. We do not know what the gravity wave universe looks like. So it's like asking the question, what would Newton have seen when he discovered the first telescope? Well, he would have discovered the visible universe. And now we have a new telescope. So what is it that we are going to see? So there's a global network happening. It's no longer called Indigo, it's called LIGO India. Indigo was a nice name, but I think it did not pass. The two LIGO detectors are in the United States, and the third one has come to India. There is one called GEO, which is 600 meters in in Germany. There is one called Virgo in Italy. There is TAMA that is coming up in Japan. Actually, TAMA is now called KAGRA. So the collaboration has expanded. It's no longer just the LIGO collaboration. It's called the LIGO-Virgo-KAGRA collaboration. All these detectors, the LIGO detector that we are building is different from the Virgo detector, which is different from the one at KAGRA. The Japanese are building one that is super cooled. But you understand why you need a network of these. If you just look at this picture. So what is happening is the gravity waves are coming in different directions. And if you look at this picture, which is Hanford-Hanford LIGO-Virgo, Livingston-Virgo. Hanford, Livingston were the three detectors in the US. And Virgo was the one in Europe, in Italy. Then you'll see that these ellipses are uncertainty bars. Balaji, you'll have to remind me if there's a chat question because I can't see the chat window.
No, don't worry about it. There'll be a few, but we'll take care of it after 20 minutes.
Okay. When you move one of these Hanford detectors from the US to India, you'll see that the uncertainty in where you can locate the origin of the gravity wave comes down dramatically in most of the universe, except on the two sides. That becomes a little better if we had. So we went with this particular plan, which is the Hanford, India, Livingston, Virgo, and now we also have KAGRA. And with these five detectors, a lot of the uncertainty in where these gravity waves are originating from is reduced. So that's the reason why people are excited, because you want to be able to say it's coming from a particular astronomical event. And today what we do is we call it multi-messenger astrophysics, where the astrophysicists who are working with telescopes or gamma rays or some other instrument will notice something, and we promptly look in our data sets to decide whether that was there was a gravity wave that was discovered out of that. I think last week also there was a major discovery that was announced. So whether it's neutron stars or binary black holes, there's always something going on in this universe of ours. I have only one slide on general relativity, and I need it to explain why that length scales are important. This one slide sort of summarizes everything that I needed to know about general relativity. There is a tensor matrix, the G mu nu, and that is a combination of two terms, eta and h, We assume that we don't really need to know very much about eta, which is unperturbed, and the perturbations due to gravity waves are all captured in this matrix called H. Gravity waves, just like electromagnetic waves, are polarized. There are two polarizations. There are H plus and HX. HX is cross diagonal. H plus is vertical and horizontal. So you can think of having two basis sets, one at vertical basis and horizontal basis, like electric fields. And then there's another basis set, which is plus 45 and 135, right? So in some sense, these things are causing our known universe to compress either horizontally or vertically. And the other one is at some angle, right? Now, when you build a Michelson interferometer, you can estimate what the accumulated round trip phase is. The accumulated round trip phase is just an integral over the total time times 2 pi the frequency dt, right? And the total round trip time is, you know, you just do the speed of light. That's not very complicated. In the presence of a gravity wave, you get a slightly different expression that requires the use of this g nu. And under various approximations, it actually turns out that you are looking at this coefficient H. This coefficient H is primarily what helps us, is what we are trying to measure, right? And this H tells us whether, you know, what sort of astronomical object is. And as I mentioned earlier, H is quite small. So the order of 10 to the power minus 20, 10 to the power minus 19, depending on what object you're trying to measure. If you do both X and Y phases, you will find that the phase difference is actually the sum of these two things. And so you'll end up with a factor of 2 extra, and you're looking at whatever this H plus is. And it turns out that the strain, that is delta L by L, so if L is the length of your interferometer, delta L is the change in the length of the interferometer, it's proportional to whatever you were trying to measure, which in this case is H plus. So this in a nutshell is why we actually build these interferometers. And by making L larger, we are trying to make delta L larger and make it measurable. As I pointed out, delta L is already a million orders smaller than the size of an atom. So, I mean, we are really stretching it even there. But that's one reason why you don't have tabletop gravity wave detectors. So first generation detector is fairly simple. It was just simple Michelson interferometer. And then what we realized, or what they realized, was that they just didn't have enough power, right? So they were using a 10 watt laser. They had a beam splitter, and they had these two arms for the interferometer. Out here, I'm showing you a more current generation, which is a 4 kilometer arm length. And the question is, why do we have these Fabry-Perot cavities at the two sides? I mean, in a conventional interferometer, you just put a mirror. You don't really need to have these Fabry-Perot cavities. What the cavity does for us is that it increases that effective length. So we want the length to increase, and it increases because of the round trip time going back, the photons bouncing back and forth between the two mirrors on the Michelson arm. They all have names. This is called an end test mass. This is called an input test mass. And although you started off with about 10 watts of laser, by the time you're looking at the power inside the cavity, you're looking at 30 kilowatts. We also realized that it was good to operate the Michelson interferometer on what is called a dark fringe. The signal to noise ratio was very high if at the interference you were actually operating on a dark fringe. And I'll come back to that in a bit. If you're on a dark fringe out here, the question is, where does the power go? Whatever power is leaking out of this cavity would then go back towards the laser, and you're losing the power. So they came up with this concept of a power recycling mirror. that was only 2.7% transmittive, and that power recycling mirror would then bounce the power back into these cavities. And that improved the energy efficiency of the entire system. And so all our interferometers now have a power recycling mirror. Now, some of the things that I think about when I look at the LIGO designs is, why can some of these not be brought into some of the experiments that we run in our labs? I mean, there's no reason that when we run an interference experiment in our lab, we cannot use a power recycling mirror. There's no reason that we cannot use Fabry-Perot cavities to enhance the sensitivity of our interferometers. So there are ideas like that that I would encourage everyone to think about while they are sort of listening to this talk, because LIGO is full of all kinds of neat tricks.
And if you look, this is a good time to take some questions.
Sure, sure, absolutely.
Okay. So there have been a few. Okay. So going back to your earlier slides, you're talking about the location of the LIGO detectors at different the gravitation wave detectors, and one question is, does the tectonic activity play a role in the choice of this detector location?
Not really. Not really. So let me see if I have a slide on that. Yeah, I do have slides coming up later on that, but I'll tell you, you have to ask the question, what is the frequency of the gravity wave that you're trying to detect? And it turns out that the tectonic shifts are actually, you know, at a much lower frequency than what we are trying to observe.
Okay.
But also, tectonic shifts, we correct for them. So we can measure them with seismometers, and then we have some feedback control that ensures that we don't mistake a tectonic disturbance for a gravity wave.
Okay, okay. So this is actually, this could double up as a seismic activity detector also.
Yeah, so.
So another question, how do we interpret the source localization error plots?
Well, so what it's telling you out here is that if I am pointing my, I skipped one equation which told us that, you know, you have two arms, and if the wave was coming from a direction where the two arms were exactly disturbed exactly in phase, so that you had exactly this term, 1 minus h and 1 plus h, then you knew that was coming at, let's say, 45 degrees. But if it's not coming at 45 degrees, it's coming at some other angle, then you get some cos theta, sine theta type terms that are used to decide what that theta is. Now, the error in that theta is reduced because you are able to correlate what is being measured in India with what is being measured in the other detectors. And actually, if you think about it, if you're, I'll give you an example. If you're, if you have got three detectors on a table, and you're trying to measure something that is on the table, then the other two detectors might block your measurement, and you don't really get any information out there. So you can measure things on the table, but you will definitely be blocking yourself. And if you want to not block yourself, you have to go off the table. So in some sense, that's what it is. And obviously, Australia or South Africa would have been a better choice. But it turns out that India is not too bad. And what it means is that within this ellipse, I cannot isolate. So if there, I cannot isolate the astronomical object within that ellipse. So if there are multiple black holes happening out there, they would all look the same for us.
Right. And on the same note, there are those red crosses. Are those blind spots in the detection? What do those signify?
Yeah, I think those were the blind spots that were there before India came online. Right. So if you have two detectors in Hanford, one in Livingston, and one in Italy, then those X's were the blind spots in the HHLB configuration.
Okay.
And for some reason, the AHLB configuration also had a few blind spots.
But with India, it seems like there is no
blind spots out there. But we do have larger uncertainties on the peripheries of our universe at this point.
Right. So one more question. The next slide. So you talked about H plus and H cross. Now we are primarily looking at the effect of H plus when we are doing X and Y. Doesn't the H cross also influence this, or is it just two representations of the same thing?
No. So this is kind of where the wave is coming well aligned to our XY detector. Mm-hmm. So that it is creating exactly this pattern out here. And so these are the modes on the top right. You'll see the modes of the gravity mm-hmm. wave, and it is compressing and expanding exactly without any rotation of the ellipse.
Mm-hmm.
So if it comes at some rotation on that ellipse in the second one, for example, if the compression is not exactly on the horizontal direction, but it's at some angle, then you will start getting terms of the H cross. The assumption is that H cross and H plus are of the same order of magnitude. So in terms of designing the interferometer, we have not really incorporated that into given it much thought. But you're right that there is a bunch of people who ask us, how should the detector in India be aligned? Should it be north south and east west, or should it be rotated a little bit? And that's a higher order correction, because right now we just build it wherever we can find land. So one of the funny conversations was when we started looking at it, they said that please find 4 kilometers by 4 kilometers square area of land in India where there are no people. And we started laughing. I'm like, come on, you want no people in 16 square kilometers in India? But it turns out that, if you go close enough to defense land, you can find something like that. So somewhere in the middle, there was some.
Right. There's one more question in the next slide. So the use of cavities is an excellent idea. But once we start using these cavities, why can't we bring down the arm length? Why do we still need to be kilometers? Can it be brought down, is the question.
Well, so there are a number of things. Nothing is free. What will happen is that you do get the advantages of having a higher power in the cavity. And when you start hitting the detector, you'll find that the higher power means that you have less shot noise. With this design, you are barely at the limit, right? So with this design, with cavities and 4 kilometers, you're barely at the limit. If you build a higher Q cavity, then yes, you can reduce the 4 kilometers even more. But what is happening is, as we increase the power, the mirrors are deforming because of the thermal effects. And so you're now coupling parametrically from the fundamental mode of the cavity to the higher order modes of the cavity. So that is becoming an issue of, it's basically a parametric noise that is starting to affect us. And that was one of the reasons that the second generation got delayed, because they hadn't anticipated it. So today what they're doing is they're actually got heater coils at the back of the mirror to correct for the parametric instabilities caused by the high powers in the cavity.
Okay. And one of the reasons I personally thought the distance is important, also the wavelength that we are trying to capture, right? What is the wavelength of these gravitational waves that we are looking at?
It's at 10 hertz. So you can, 100 hertz, 10 hertz is what we are trying
right.
to capture.
So that is the order of kilometers also, right? So
in this particular slide, you'll see that there's lots of information here, and I'll talk about it later, but we're in the range of 100 hertz at this point. I think the latest discoveries were around 80 to 100 hertz, where we're at the minimum. We're trying to push this even further down, because the neutron stars are all sitting somewhere at sub 100 hertz, tens of hertz.
Okay.
So that's still a bit of a challenge.
Right. And the cavity has its own longitudinal modes. So how does that play a role in terms of determining the frequency width of the laser itself, I suppose? If you're talking about kilometers, the longitudinal mode spacing may be in the order of picometers. I don't know. I've not done the math.
But. So these cavities are all stabilized, and we remove all the higher order modes. So we have regular what are called mode cleaners. This is like the simplest picture.
I was thinking more about the longitudinal modes of the cavity.
Yeah. So the longitudinal modes of the cavity are all within the resolution of bandwidths of our detectors right now, because we have very high finesse cavities and long cavities. So we have not encountered the longitudinal modes of the detectors. We do have longitudinal modes of the laser itself and all the other cavities. You see, we have lots of cavities out here. There's a cavity out here. Right, and then there's a cavity out here, and when I show you a more complicated picture, there are cavities all over the place. So I think people eliminate a lot of them using mode cleaners.
Okay, fine. And there's one more question. I think it's something that you'll probably come back to, saying how do we make sure that the error due to alignment issues is minimal?
Yeah, I will talk to that.
Okay. So we'll let you go through the rest of the talk. Yeah, thank you.
So this is what a typical picture looks like, okay? Length sensing and control. So what I was showing you was a very simple one. The next one is something we already talked about, that we are operating on the dark port. And so we don't, we get better SNR operating on the dark port. But that means that we don't have enough signal to actually stabilize the cavity. So we use other lasers to stabilize the cavity and things like that. So the way this, so one of the other drawbacks of LIGO is that there are acronyms all over the place, right? And I will tell you a few of them that I can remember. The PRM is the power recycling mirror. The SRM will be the signal recycling mirror. BS is the beam splitter. The ETM is end test mass X and end test mass Y. ITM and Y and ITMX will be internal test mass X and internal test mass Y, and so on, right? There's a whole bunch of acronyms. But if you follow the light path, what you'll actually see is that there will be the interferometer itself is out here, and you have the signal recycling mirrors and the power recycling mirrors. So let me show you another configuration and you'll understand this better. So you have the modes of an interferometer in a simple Michelson, and then you have Fabry-Perot cavities that are added, and then you add power recycling mirror out here to send whatever leakage power back into the cavities, and then you add a signal recycling mirror to improve the kind of signal that you're getting out here. So there's another cavity that is formed between the signal recycling mirror and the intermediate or internal IM, I think it will be defined somewhere out there. Input mirror X and input mirror Y. There will be a signal recycling mirror out here that also improves the signal to noise ratio. So in some sense, this is the base design, except that it still doesn't have all the mode cleaners that are required in order to address the issues that you were talking about. The laser line width that we're talking about out here is, I think currently it's less than 100 kilohertz, right? It's a fairly narrow line width laser, and they have actually been able to build a fiber laser also with that. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me see. I do have a little more detail on this one, and you'll notice that the advanced LIGO is no longer using 10 watts. It is now at 180 watts, and the power in the cavity is no longer kilowatts, it's now a megawatt. You have a megawatt of power inside these cavities, and you can imagine the kind of deformations that are happening on the mirrors. So you really need to have very, very good mirrors. As I said, this is the second generation, and the third generation where we're hoping to do better. We are moving away from metallic mirrors to silicon mirrors. We are moving to silicon mirrors. Silicon mirrors are just going to be polished silicon. And the reason we are doing that is because it has better noise properties. So we have to understand what are the different sources of noise. And I will talk about that briefly. Before I do that, I want to you to understand that none of these mirrors are sitting on a table. They're all suspended. They're all on triple pendulum suspensions. Each suspension improves, has a transfer function, and I think this particular picture shows that. What you're seeing out here are examples of single suspension and double suspension, and each time, and quadruple suspension and triple suspension. So each time you get an improvement of 1 over f. You get 1 over f, 1 over f square, 1 over f, 1 over f square, 1 over f fourth, 1 over f sixth, 1 over f eighth, and so on. So a lot of work goes into designing these suspensions, and the idea is that you're isolating the mirrors from the seismic noise. Today, the isolations are so complex. It's about 250 parameter control system that is being designed used in order to correct for all these noises. So, if a truck goes on the highway, we correct for it. If a person sneezes in the room, we correct for it. We can correct for pretty much anything that is thrown at it, because the control systems are all designed to do that. What we are not correcting for so far, which is sort of crazy in my mind, is let us say that in the laboratory, a student is sitting, and then the student gets up and he moves the chair. So when he moves the chair, he generates Newtonian noise, because Newton's law says that G m1 m2 by r square, and because he's moved the chair, r has changed, and so the mirrors pick that up. And so we are now trying to control for what we call Newtonian noise by saying that any object that is there in the vicinity of the mirrors, the input mirrors, we are going to account for that and correct for that noise also, right? So that is how we are getting to these obscene levels of sensitivity. Okay, so we start looking at all the noises, right? Fighting noise. So this dotted line here was the first generation, and you can see that they weren't doing very well. And then the factor of 10 improvement came by beating up on these noises. So there's short noise from the detector. There is thermal noise in the suspensions. There is seismic noise that was there without it being corrected, and in the initial detector. Then what we've done is we have reduced the short noise till we have gotten to the quantum limits. We have improved the suspension designs, and the suspension designs are now, because of the 1 over f to the power 8, the suspension designs are well below the other noises, so we don't worry about them too much. The thermal noise, which is the noise that is picked up in the mirrors, is still a problem, and that is what we are fighting with, because we want to bring this down at least till the green curve. The mirrors themselves will have some peaks, and you will see that in the graphs that there will be some longitudinal mode of the mirrors that cause trouble. Oh, I forgot this. There is one advantage to moving a detector to India. We also pick up a lot of noise due to the electrical frequency, and 50 hertz, 60 hertz equipment can be a problem. So all the American equipment is running at 60 hertz, and we are at 50 hertz. So while they cannot pick up anything at their 60 hertz frequencies, I think we are 50 and they are 60, but vice versa also, right? We can pick it up out here. So there is one advantage of that, and there are known sources that are expected to be there at that particular frequency. Okay. So the length control was one of the questions that was asked. Here you'll see a little more detail. You will see the mode cleaner, And you'll see all the acronyms for different reflections. Reflection 9, 27, 45, 135 are all coming from different mirrors at different locations. They are being picked out. There is an output mode cleaner that will also clean the modes at the output before it goes to the detector. And then there is all these different signals that are being picked up, and then they're fed through demodulators and frequency multipliers and so on back to an electro-optic modulator that then modulates a laser and stabilizes the entire system. So here we are showing you only about six of them, but there are about 200 such different control signals all over the place that are correcting various things. So it's fairly complicated as we start doing this. We typically use what is called a Pound Driver Hall system. In the simplest cavity, this is a Pound Driver Hall system. And you know, this is again something that is used very commonly in physics labs, wherever people run atom trap type experiments. This is also a very interesting experiment for our students to set up. I would encourage people to just, it's a very simple polarizing beam splitter, mixer, phase modulator type experiment. And the main challenges are out here are generating these type of signals. And the error signal for a Pound Driver Hall will look like this. So every time the cavity is detuned, you'll get something like this. And then you sort of tune the cavity back out here, right? As I said, suspensions are important. So the mirrors are mounted on these four quadruple suspensions. There is a cantilever at the top. And then now we are hanging these mirrors, and then from those mirrors we are hanging two more mirrors, and we are welding the fibers. So earlier they were using stainless steel, and stainless steel was picking up a lot of thermal noise, and so now we are using glass fiber. Just to tell you how sensitive this thing is, the detector in Italy, Virgo, was delayed by about a year and a half. They never understood why this fused silica fiber was breaking and the mirrors would crash to the floor. These mirrors weigh about 2 kilograms. And so when they fall, they cannot be reused. And then they had to go and get a new one made. And then they installed the new one, and after a week, that one crashed. And they were not happy, and they did a lot of investigative analysis, and it turned out that one of the noise sources that we have not talked about so far is the noise caused by atoms in the cavity itself. So when molecules within the cavity, when the gas molecules within the cavity are moving around, what happens is that they also scatter light, and that scattered light shows up as noise. So to make this work, the 4 kilometer tubes are evacuated completely. Now at the end of that 4 kilometer tube is the input mirror, and these input mirrors are being evacuated through vacuum pumps. While they were evacuating it, those gas molecules, air molecules, were hitting the glass fiber. And the glass fiber is under so much strain that the molecules of gas hitting the fiber was enough for the fiber to break. Right. So these are sort of ridiculous problems to have. I do not know how they do this, but they do it, right? It's absolutely crazy that they're able to do something like this. The mirrors themselves are super polished. This is a particular mirror. You'll see the mirror down here. It's being polished, and it's polished to 1 micron smoothness. The mirrors are fairly big themselves. This particular one is about 300 millimeters, 30 centimeters. This is a small mirror. The mirrors are getting larger. So as you make your cavity larger and larger, there is diffraction of light happening. And that mirror has to be as large as the beam so that you don't lose any power. And so that is also something that is a big challenge for everybody, right? This picture I showed you earlier, so I will just talk you through this. So you'll notice out here the engineering work that has been done. You know, between May 2001 and April 2005, all that they have done is they've done better engineering. you had so many noisy peaks and they went after each of them and they removed them. You had the baseline noises, short noise and thermal noise. You had the peaks of the suspensions and they started eliminating them one by one. And you'll notice across the years, 5 years of work, they are able to come down to this purple curve, right? So this purple curve was what allowed them to discover the gravity waves. And that was possible because of good engineering. They still have these violent modes of the suspensions. As I said, there is something out here at 50, 60 hertz that is related to the electrical equipment in the laboratories. But other than that, they have been able to hit some of the best sensitivities that they could theoretically predict. So by characterizing the noise for every source is how they have actually been able to reach this. So the displacement in meters per root hertz is now sitting at about 10 to the power minus 19 or maybe 10 to the power minus 18 depending on the frequency. And there's not very much happening at the, you know, 1 kilohertz type scale. Most astronomical events are all sitting down here. More of them at the lower frequencies, and that becomes harder because the seismic noises start accumulating. And as I said, you know, we're now trying to worry about Newtonian noise. There are interesting proposals out there on how do you mitigate seismic noise and Newtonian noise, but that's for another talk. So I'll stop with this particular slide because I think this is the best slide to explain why engineering is needed even in a science experiment. The LIGO scientific collaboration itself has got 40 institutions, about 550 scientists. It keeps changing. The Indigo collaboration became a part of it and is now called LIGO India. But you'll notice that all over the place you have you know, universities that are participating in this. The two main ones are Caltech and MIT. But there are other collaborations now that are coming up, which are not LIGO. They're called Einstein Observatory or LISA and so on. Okay. Am I out of time?
Yeah, I mean, you're right there. We thought it'd be a 1 hour talk and okay. It's just about an hour right now. Maybe there are a few more questions. First of all, thank you. Thank you for this fascinating talk. It's really a lot of information and you know, I think we'll have a long discussion in the classroom also beyond this, I think.
What I would suggest is that, you know, I can share that paper with you guys and, you know, it's called Gravitational Wave Detection, Gravitational Radiation Detection with Laser Interferometry. It's a 2019 paper. I think maybe it's on the archives and I might be able to just post the link. I think if you are able to do that, go through that, then you'll find a lot more information. What I not covered is, you know, the next generation is using squeezed light, which is reducing quantum noise. And
right.
That I've not really covered. I thought it might be a little too much for the first talk. But, you know, all the other sources of noise and the quantum noise are there in this archive paper. So I would recommend people to sort of go through that. It's an easy to read paper, so it's not too complicated.
Actually, I have a couple of questions and then I'll open the floor for other students also to ask their own questions. The violin modes that you talked about, those peaks in that noise spectrum. Now, these modes are happening at relatively low frequencies, I see. So, isn't it, you know, straightforward to cancel them also because they know we are getting those at a very specific frequency, so we could go ahead and cancel them?
No, I think we're not able to eliminate them completely. I think what we do is we use electrostatic dampers to reduce it, but we're not able to cancel them out completely.
Okay.
And there are many reasons for that. I mean, we think that these are normal modes, but you know, they sort of, there's a lot of crosstalk between the modes also happening. So to first order, we correct it, but then the second order shows up and things like that.
Right. And one more question is, you talked about some of these, you know, anything and everything can actually be a source of noise. You're talking about this Newtonian motion, you know, those sort of things can also create noise and how you're compensating for that. But the question is, how do you know it's the noise and not the signal itself? I suppose that's a classic issue, right?
But see, a gravity wave signal is a correlation between three detectors or four detectors across the Earth. So okay, local noises okay. are very easy to remove.
Right. Okay. Okay.
The bigger questions, and there are, I think one of Giri's former PhD students, she's keeps raising this question that, how do you know it's not atmospheric or ionosphere turbulence that is causing something? Because that is something that will be common across all three or four detectors. I think there are lots of people who look at these things and try to argue that, no, these are actually astrophysical events. And these days what happens is, because the communication is so good, when either the LIGO detector detects something, or the astronomers detect something, they inform the other parties, and then we go look in that direction. So now there is confirmation that it is an astrophysical event, because it is multi-messenger astronomy. There's a messenger which is either gamma rays or X-rays or something else visible. And then there is the gravity wave also, both coming from the same location, which is unlikely to happen if it's the ionosphere or whatever, right?
So, right.
So there, I think we have a little more confidence that it is actually an astrophysical event.
Okay, great. I'll open the floor for other people to ask questions. Guys, feel free to ask your own questions. I've been putting it up on chat box so far. Well, in that case, I have one more question related to something that we'd been talking about in the class. So there is this technique that we just have been discussing the last couple of sessions called phase-generated carrier technique. I do see one of your slides was showing a phase modulator at the output of the laser. Do they use sort of like a phase modulation to sort of have a carrier on which you can lock in and do your
very
detection?
Much. So what they do is they modulate and then they use the side bands to lock onto it. They lock onto the side bands.
They don't use the
carrier because that just messes up their signal to noise.
Right. And the side bands are the ones that have the information.
So we
went through that thing. So I wanted to make sure that we did something useful in the last couple of sessions.
Let me show you that. Hold on. The Poundrava locking system can also get fairly complicated.
The slides. We're still at the.
Oh, you're still at that one, is it?
Last slide. It froze.
Let me see how I can fix that. Just give me a second. Weber is asking the correlations across model real time. If not, will real time
help? You can read it now.
It is reasonably. It does not need to be real time because data is right now being archived everywhere. And anyway, nobody announces it in real time. We take 6 months before we announce it because we are verifying all of these things. Actually, it's very interesting. So the stories are, you know, before the first detection, how do you know that you have actually not just found some noise? There is a team within the scientific collaboration that feeds fake data into the database.
It's a fire drill.
Yeah, it's a fire drill. So if the algorithms pick up something out there, they're like, nah, you know, this is not ready yet. They had gone through this many times, and so they were not sure whether when the announcement was actually going to happen, whether they had detected something real. But they figured it was real because instead of having plastic glasses, they had champagne glasses. So everyone suddenly said, okay, this is the real one. So the cat was out of the bag because of that. But otherwise, you know, there's a lot of blind tests that are going on to ensure that, you know, it's not fake data that is being captured.
I suppose it's all real time these days, right? All the centers are networked and they...
Yeah. I mean, real time as in maybe there's a speed of light delay across the earth. But otherwise, so the data is being archived. Of course, in the US, there are archives, but there's also one archive that's come up in Pune so that Indian researchers can get it almost real time without having to wait. You know, so
Cool.
So India is one of the archive centers. Okay, so I posted the link out here, and let me just show you the other one.
So there's one more question: how to get the time information from the detected gravitational wave? So the time reference, I suppose, is the question.
I think it's a global clock that people are sharing, but otherwise it's fairly easy, right? You just do a correlation between known signals. And you are able to correct for any sort of offsets out there. So time is not a big thing for us right now. Time offsets are easy to do. This is a typical Pound Trevor Hall that I was showing you earlier, and you know, there are these papers out here that anyway, this is Wikipedia that you can find out, but there is this other paper out here that I can also copy over into the chat window for people. Right. Mr. D, I think.
Partially.
No, that Trevor was Mr. D.
Okay. That's a classic paper.
So the modulation sidebands, right? There's a carrier and then there's first order, second order, and so on. And then when you do the amplitude modulation, you have a lower order sideband and a higher order sideband. So that's exactly what we are kind of using for all the locking. We don't really mess with the carrier too much.
Yes.
And I think that's what you were referring to.
That's
and,
right. Yeah, that's yeah. that's what we went through, all these Bessel functions and how you pick out all these different orders. Yeah.
That's right. So these are different. Yeah. So I think that's, and there is some math associated with this. You know, these slides that I'm looking at right now have actually come from a guy called Suresh at IUCA. He's spent almost 15 years in the LIGO collaboration, and he's very well known. He is also conducting the summer internship program for students every year. So if there are students interested in learning more, you know, they sign up for these internship programs and they get trained hands-on.
So, yeah. Hopefully, one of the people in the audience would take note of that.
You know, that I had a student, a dual degree student, who used the opportunity and went to Caltech. Not Caltech. He went to Livingston and he spent 3 months there at the detector site.
Yeah.
He came back saying he doesn't want to talk to a physicist ever again in his life. All they do is talk about physics. So, there are no guarantees out here.
But some people might like it, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that's just a warning, fair disclaimer, warning and everything. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you
Thank
so
you
much.
Thank you very much.
Once again, Anil.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.